but before that, they were floating without one. Which kind of makes me wonder why they didn't just pick a random kid and be like, you're fucking...
floating.
Oh,
I see
look
what
at you with
did
the
there.
Pies.
But why didn't they just pick a random fucking kid and be like, you're the seeker.
Congrats, kid, it's you. Look out.
Right.
Maybe they wanted to find someone with talent? I don't...
Well, I know, but if you were coming down to your first game of the season, like, you'd rather have somebody than nobody.
I thought it was more like, it was the beginning of school. So in my head, it was like, it was just starting. Like, it was just tryouts and stuff. They were just doing tryouts and stuff. Like, they hadn't even gotten to the point of, this is the team. I thought, in my head.
It very quickly goes to the first game. And I don't know. When we got to the first game, it seemed like they had already been playing for... Not they had, but the school had already been having games.
The season had already been going.
Right. The other teams, I think, had some games. Just the Gryffindor team hadn't. So they maybe had missed out on some practice because they didn't have a seeker. And that's all I'm saying. That I would think that they had a placeholder just in case.
Yeah, they definitely should have. Professional teams do. I know even high school teams have the second string guys.
I really thought some crappy kid got benched. I don't know.
And even this late in the season, they should have just picked some kid to be, like, reserve.
Right. Oh, yeah. Because
they have a first year. It's a first year being a fucking seeker. He could get pegged by a bludger any time. That's all.
No, you're absolutely right.
And then Neville falls into the room with his legs in a leg locker curse. And he had to, like, bunny hop all the way to the portrait hole. And they don't know how he got in there. Which, it's another thing we talked about. The portrait hole is definitely up high. It's not on the ground. Because they were like, how the fuck did he climb in there?
Oh, yeah. We get a better visual of that.
Yeah, because if it was a regular doorway, he could have hopped in easy. But they were like, what?
My imaginative little brain right now is thinking that he finally remembered the password. And then it swung open. And then he just did one of those, like... and, like, flung himself in there.
Do you remember the show Hole in the Wall?
Yeah, where the I do.
It's kind of like that, I think.
Yeah.
I've never heard of it.
There were holes in the wall.
And then you flung yourself in it.
Yeah, you had to, like, form to the holes and try and make it through it. It came at you. The wall came at you.
Okay, James, you're on a platform in a pool. And they would send this wall made of foam, but they would send this wall towards you with different shapes that a body can make cut in it. And so you had to conform to the shape and fit through the hole in the wall, otherwise it would push you off the platform into the pool,
I'm doing shapes.
And then you lost. It was kind of fun to watch, because people would get close, and then they get clobbered in the fucking head when it came by.
Yeah.
And it would go faster as you progressed. So when he got to the last round, it would, like, right off the platform. It was fucking funny. So I don't see how any of the teachers could have let Malfoy get away with that. Like, doing that to Neville, they have rules and shit about that at the school that we have heard Hermione gripe about to the boys. And he does this to them. What kind of makes it worse is everyone laughs. So not only did no teacher help him, he had to hop all the way up to the Gryffindor common room. I think he kind of folded himself over the threshold and then kicked his legs over to prevent the complete throw into the hole in the wall. But he had to go through all that, and nobody helps him until Hermione helps him. And, yeah, nobody does shit to help him. I don't think that's cool at all.
No, that's really sad.
I think he may have just been, I don't know, lucky, unlucky... that a teacher didn't walk past him. Because they say, tell a teacher, you need to tell a teacher. And he's like, no, man, I'm not going to ask for more punishment on top of what I'm already getting.
One of the ghosts or the paintings that can move to room to room?
Yeah, they should have seen him, but I mean, I don't know that they care enough to tell.
That's what it kind of made it sound like. Even if there was somebody that saw him, they just kind of laughed at him.
Yeah.
Is what I'm guessing anyways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's always a class clown.
I did think it was interesting, though, that Hermione said to tell. Ron says to stand up to him and, like, you know, put his dukes up. And then Harry just gives him candy and encouragement. Like, it's very fitting for each of their personality. Hermione is like, tell a fucking teacher. That's what you do. Ron is like, no, you beat his ass or you tell him to leave you alone. And Harry is just like, here's some candy and, like, chin up, bud.
I kind of wondered where Harry got that part of his personality, because his mom and dad sounded like great people. His aunt and uncle and cousin are shitty people. And so I think he's a compassionate person, but I wonder if that was just given to him through his parents, or if that's a learned trait because of dealing with, like, the Dursleys.
I think it's an argument for nature versus nurture. I tend to believe that it was more a trait handed down from, like, his mom.
Nature.
Yeah.
Fair.
I am going to take the other side on this, and I am going to say because of his shitty treatment that was given to him, he feels compelled to treat others the way he wanted to be treated.
I agree.
It's like the first episode all over again. I agree. And that's all he said.
Say it again. Say it again that you agree with me. Let's just take that in for a minute. He's agreeing with me. Can we feel that, people? Can we just absorb this for a minute?
But I do think it's sad because it's clear Malfoy has completely broken Neville. Like, he's got no will to fight back at all.
It's very sad.
And I think he needed every single thing that his friends did for him in that moment.
Be prepared to take your shots, listeners. Malfoy is a dick.
Oh, he's such a dick.
That's what I got written down to.
Neville's worth 12 of him.
You're damn right. That was awesome. He says one thing that stuck out to me a little bit. He goes, "You don't have to tell me that I'm not brave enough to be in Gryffindor, because Malfoy already told me that. So you can spare me that." I don't know why nobody told Neville. It's not solely based on bravery. They may not have real knowledge of what the Sorting Hat really thinks, or if there's a pattern to how he chooses which house you're going to be in, but they have, you know, attributes each house is kind of known for having, and bravery is not the only one on there.
Right.
So just that came up, you could be like, yeah, but you're like an honorable dude, you know, you're a good person, and that's why you're in Gryffindor. That's not to be overlooked, dude.
Yeah.
So I guess I just didn't like it because Malfoy took a shot and it really hurt Neville. But if Neville had thought about it a little bit, he would have seen that it was total bullshit. And Malfoy really doesn't have anything on him.
Right.
Because he's a dick.
Harry gives Neville one of the chocolate frogs that he got from Hermione for Christmas. The last one that he had in his pocket from the pack. So he's eating it, delicious, and realizes that the wizard card that they get inside is Dumbledore again. Now, I was wondering if he could see through the cards like the other paintings could around the castle.
You mean like the painting of the fat lady that they can literally talk to?
Yes. Was he just popping in to check on what they were doing and talking about? Or did he specifically give the card present with Harry?
You think somehow magically he...
Like the photos, like the pictures of the fat lady.
So Dumbledore can keep an eye on Harry no matter what he's doing.
Right. Ron makes it specific that Dumbledore is gone after Harry first reads the card. And he says, well, you don't expect him to hang around all day.
I think this, we had talked about this in an earlier episode, that we didn't think that these people, because a lot of these people are dead, so they aren't like actual, they're just representations, they're like shades of these people. And Dumbledore doesn't have a painting of himself in his office until after he dies.
Correct.
So I don't think that he has any control over these paintings. Like, I think they're each their own little entities that have his personality, but I don't think he can control them like that. It would be cool if he did, but I don't think he had any control over
I like
those
my
cards.
Theory better.
It's a badass theory. I hadn't considered that. And when he said it, I was like, holy fuck, he might be right.
It's
like specifically if
it was specifically set up that Dumbledore made sure Harry got that card so he could be present with him throughout his entire
stay everything. At Hogwarts. That's really creepy. It's a little stalkerish.
It depends a lot on chance. On the chance of him getting the right card, on the chance of him keeping the right card.
On the chance of him even getting a frog. What if he didn't like chocolate? That's what I'm saying.
Like, off the trolley. There's just a lot of things that could have taken that off the rails.
Oh, for sure.
I hit a point. Yay! Powder point!
James gets a point.
But yeah, after they get the card, Harry reads it back and they find Flamel's name. Fucking finally.
I love the way he reads it. He's like, oh man, I got Dumbledore.
The whole light bulb has turned on.
And as soon as they do, Hermione rushes upstairs to get her book. And she's like, hold the fuck on. I'll be right back. Do you want to be right back too? Do you want to take a break?
You know what? I think that's a good idea, Jade. Why don't we pause and have a little beer break?
All right. Beer break.
I think that's a good idea.
What are we drinking tonight, guys?
We got a brand new one from Elk.
Yeah.
Hazelnut chocolate peanut butter, and it's delicious.
It was weird because, it's not weird. It's really, really tasty, but it tastes like it would be a dark beer, and it's not. It's bright yellow and fizzy.
It's a blonde.
It's a blonde, yeah. And like you said, chocolate and hazelnut, you can taste that.
And peanut, butter.
Yeah.
There was a nutty aftertaste.
Yeah, little nut in your mouth at the end.
At the end.
No big deal.
Everybody goes home happy.
We're also drinking KBS from Founders again.
So I think with that, we all have a nice refill. Cool. Well, hey. Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
And let's get back after it.
So Hermione jumped up and ran to go get that giant book. And she told the boys to just wait until she got back. We're never told the title of this book or what it's about. I'm guessing it's alchemy because that's the only other thing on the card other than his name that we're told. She pulls it out and she goes and she says this. She checked it out for a bit of light reading and Ron's all like, really? Light reading?
I think maybe she was just showing off a little bit there.
A little bit.
Just sticking it to him like, this is what I do with my spare time. What do you do, Ron?
Wizard chest.
Right. Apparently that's the only thing Ron's good at.
So if she specifically knew that that was in that book that she had once... They had said the name just randomly. Why did she then remember about it?
I think that the book that she had up in her room was specifically about alchemy. Because why else would she have been like, oh shit, I have a book that contains that knowledge. But she hadn't found his name in it yet. I don't think she had cracked that book open. Because she hadn't realized he had something to do with alchemy. So once they connected the dots, she was like... Oh shit, I have something. And then she flipped through the book and found his name in it. She didn't know for sure it was in there until that moment. And then she found the rest of the information about how he was the only known maker of the Sorcerer's Stone.
Right.
Dun, dun, dun. So the Sorcerer's Stone is something that's pretty badass. It turns metal into gold. And it can create the elixir of life.
Making you immortal.
Right. Fucking badass. So the question that came to my mind is, and they do discuss it, what would you do if you got the Sorcerer's Stone?
You wouldn't have to do anything. You would be rich and live forever.
You totally took my answer. I wouldn't do a fucking thing. Absolutely nothing. I would have people to do that, and I would have things to do that, and I would have all the money to facilitate all of this.
Yeah.
And it would be fantastic.
Simple.
This, but better.
Exactly.
like sitting around drinking with my friends, talking about my favorite things, but like it was coming.